This episode of Because Science is sponsored by Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order.
At this point, I'd guess a significant percentage of Earth's population knows what this is. But what about this? What is a darksaber? And how does it work? Let's get technical. The darksaber first appeared in Star Wars canon back in the Clone Wars TV show in 2010. It may not be as flashy looking as a lightsaber, but it's definitely more mysterious and very cool looking. A singular weapon crafted by the first Mandalorian Jedi. It may be shaped a bit differently, but it's supposed to function just like a regular lightsaber in that it's very hot and glowy and it can cut through stuff with ease. But how can it function just like a lightsaber if the darksaber's design is based on, apparently, the absence of what makes a lightsaber a lightsaber? Whoops. First, what is a lightsaber? Well, my pet explanation that is the correct one is that a lightsaber is hot and dangerous, just like Han Solo, because it is a tightly confined ring of ultra-hot plasma, kept in place by ludicrously strong and helical magnetic fields and powered by something. A lightsaber's plasma emits enough light and heat to slice through just about anything. Oh. If a darksaber is supposed to operate in a similar way, then it should be designed in a similar way, right? Well, I'm not so sure. Star Wars lore implies that a darksaber is just a lightsaber that uses black plasma instead of another color like blue or green, but I don't think that's right. If you could see the atoms and the molecules that make up the air you're breathing right now, you would find that everything is more or less together. Nuclei and these atoms have their associated electrons and everything's chill. But if we started adding heat to the equation or applied a very strong electromagnetic field, you'd find that things get decidedly less chill as atoms and molecules have their electrons ripped from them and everything is bouncing around and gaining more and more energy. Oh, not chill. This is now plasma, one of the four states of matter, gas that is partially or fully ionized. And a plasma can have a huge temperature range, from basically cold enough for you to touch, like the plasma inside of a fluorescent light tube in your office building that makes you look sick, to hand cutting and star hot, something you should definitely not just grab. Ah, this kind of heat, if a darksaber has it, is why it needs to be something else. Can I get a robot hand, please? Anything with a temperature above absolute zero will emit radiation. For example, you with a human body temperature emit radiation in the range of about 10 micrometers in terms of wavelength. This is infrared, and it's also why infrared cameras are good at finding humans like you, and maybe me. A star, on the other robot hand, is hot enough to emit radiation across the electromagnetic spectrum, from IR up through visible radiation and all the way to X-ray. The relationship between an object's temperature and the wavelength of radiation it's putting out can be characterized by what's called Wien's Displacement Law, which sketches out a graph as you see here. Hotter and hotter objects, if you look at the graph, emit shorter and shorter wavelengths, which is why some of the hottest stars are blue hot, even white hot. Now, if a lightsaber and a darksaber are hot enough to cut and cauterize, then they should be star hot, very, very hot. And looking at a normal lightsaber, you can infer from its color that it must be thousands of Kelvin. And there's no room on this graph for black plasma. So since the canon is wide open as to how a darksaber is actually made, I'm gonna suggest that it's exactly what it looks like, a black hole blade. Ooh. I know that sounds extreme and it would introduce a number of problems. However, a black hole blade would explain a few crucial aspects of darksaber design. First of all, the look. You probably already know that a black hole looks the way it does because any light that would be reflected off of it and returned to your eye is instead funneled down into oblivion. Why though? If you wanted to leave the Earth, and I don't blame you, the minimum velocity you would need to give yourself is the velocity that would take you infinitely far away from the planet without ever falling back down the gravity well. If you consider your total amount of energy before and after escape, your kinetic energy and your gravitational potential energy, you find that once you're infinitely far away from Earth, slowing all the way down to zero, this side of the equation afterwards just goes to zero. So you can solve this side, giving you the equation for escape velocity. If you ignore air resistance and plug in Earth's digis, you get an escape velocity of around 11 kilometers per second. Now notice how this relationship depends on both the mass of the body and the radius of the body, and therefore there's no real upper bound on escape velocity. In theory, an object could have an escape velocity higher than, say, the speed of light, and some do. Any object with a mass and radius sufficient to make its escape velocity higher than the speed of light is necessarily a black hole. Not even light, going the fastest speed there is in the universe, can escape it, and therefore it gets this characteristic voidness. If a darksaber had a similar inescapability, it might look right, just like we see it in Star Wars, but where is this glow coming from? And is this what kids call a glow-up? I have no idea. Because black holes gobble up the information that would let us observe them directly, we have to rely on indirect evidence of their existence, like their warping of space-time or the changing orbits of planets and stars in their vicinity. But black holes aren't always so passive. As we explained in a previous episode about turning Jupiter into a star using a black hole, in the presence of this kind of gravity, material will swirl around down the gravity well, forming what's called an accretion disk that gets hotter and hotter as that material smashes up against itself. Accretion disks around black holes can get so hot, in fact, that they can outshine entire galaxies. Now imagine a darksaber with similar properties. It would have this characteristic voidness, but then it might also have that glow around the edge of the blade in the form of a mini accretion disk as material, like the air that it's in, falls down into it and creates temperatures that should be hot enough to slice through a sarlacc, or another Star Wars word that begins with S. Saba the Hutt. No. A black hole blade would also explain the darksaber's final curious property. Its attraction. In Star Wars lore, the darksaber has an almost magnet-like pulling effect on other objects, most notably other lightsabers, and this could be a black hole's doing too. Technically, everything in the universe is pulling on everything else at all times, no matter the mass and no matter the distance. The moon is pulling on you right now, as is Pluto, as am I, no matter how far apart we actually are. Most of the time, this pulling is so small that you don't even notice. But if you put a black hole in a sword, you'd feel it. A black hole on the scale of something like a sword would be really heavy. Like trillions and trillions of kilograms heavy. And so, according to the force of gravity, if you held this much mass, just maybe an arm's length away, you would be subjected to an incredible pulling force, so much that you would need something like 6 billion of our best rockets to pull you in the opposite direction. Everything near a black hole blade would be incredibly attracted to it. And as you can see, this is where we start running into problems. Unfortunately, a black hole darksaber creates as many problems as it solves. Ah! The heaviest actual sword ever used in human combat didn't weigh all that much, maybe around 15 pounds or so. But a black hole somehow shaped into blade form would be a bit heavier. A black hole blade would obviously be so massive, no one could ever swing it, no one could ever lift it, and it wouldn't just attract other objects like lightsabers at arm's length. It would rip you apart. For example, if you took a black hole darksaber and put it on the opposite side of the planet, it would still pull on you with 70 pounds of force, even a planet away. So you can imagine, if you were close enough to wield this thing, it would spaghettify. The other big problem is shape. A source of gravity pulls inwards in all directions through an object's center of gravity. Not an actual point, just the mathematical average of where all the weight is. Now, what shape would you expect these forces to make something? Gravity acts to make everything in the universe a sphere. Well, why then isn't everything in the universe spherical, a young Padawan might ask? Well, that's because gravity is very weak, the weakest of nature's fundamental forces. You can beat it right now on this planet with a simple hop. So it's just the case that most smaller objects have internal forces and structures that are stronger than gravity. It's not until you have like the mass of a planet that gravity starts spherifying stuff. In fact, that's one of the ways we classify planets. If a Darksaber was really made from or had the properties of a black hole, there is very little chance that it would maintain this shape. It would probably immediately return to a sphere, and then it's not a saber anymore, is it? It's like a spheritar. No, that's worse than Therm Scissor Punch. That doesn't work. So, where does that leave the Darksaber? Well, a black hole blade would be able to explain the look, the glow, and the cutting heat, in my estimation, but it would create the immediate problems of mass, shape, and spaghettifying gravity. My idea only really half works here, but it's the best scientific analog I could find, and it's better than the Force or Kyber crystals, because those don't really have good explanations themselves. It's not a perfect explanation, sir, but it checks out. Kinda. Because science.
Thanks again to Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order for sponsoring today's episode. You play Cal Kestis, a Jedi Padawan who narrowly escaped the purge of Order 66 following the events of Episode 3 Revenge of the Sith. On a quest to rebuild the Jedi Order, you must pick up the pieces of your shattered past to complete your training, develop new powerful force abilities, and master the art of the iconic lightsaber, all while staying one step ahead of the Empire and its deadly Inquisitors. Fallen Order is available on Xbox One, PS4, and PC on November 15th.
Look, I'll be the first to admit that this is certainly not a perfect explanation. It has a lot of problems, but then we'd be in very good company with most Star Wars technology. Why don't blasters just shoot plasma that kind of like expands like a little fart out and does nothing? Why does anti-gravity tech work on spaceships? Why Ewoks? There's a lot of problems with everything. Yub-nub.